Okay, it's time to get started with today's activities. Motivated individuals and community organizations are the engines that can drive grassroots policy change. And in this panel, we will hear from three leaders in the disability community who have been leading the charge of creating policy by and for people with disabilities. These experts will discuss the role of stakeholders in all parts of policy development and implementation. First, we will hear from Liz Weintraub with the Association of University Centers on Disabilities, who will discuss the impetus for the Tuesdays with Liz weekly video series. Next, Jeff Johnson will discuss his efforts at Missouri People First and will describe a project on segregated education and the school-to-prison pipeline. Clark Rachfal will round out the panel by discussing his policy role at the American Council of the Blind. So let's get going with Liz. Please welcome Liz Weintraub. Liz, can you turn your camera on now? She is Senior Advocacy Specialist at the Association of University Centers on Disabilities. She is also the host of Tuesdays with Liz, Disability Policy for All. And her presentation today is Why Policy Needs to Be Accessible for All. Go ahead, Liz.
Thank you, Joanne. And thank you, everyone, for inviting me to speak to you today. My description is I'm a short white woman with black hair. Silver glasses. And I'm wearing a blue jacket with a purplish, reddish blouse. So that's my description. As Joan said, this presentation is called Policy. Why policy need to be accessible for all, and I mean all. Who am I? Well, I am a self-advocate. I advocate for myself. I advocate when I want something to, what I want for dinner to my husband, and that's a picture of him. We were in Vermont, where his family has a house. On top is my sister. I'm a sister of three amazing people who help me every day. And then I'm a wife to my husband. I'm a daughter to my parents. On the blow, and I'm not good with left and right. So, on the blow right, on the right side, and they're no longer here, so I miss them every day. And I try to be a friend to all. I say, I try because that's up to you whether I'm a friend to all. The backstory of Tuesdays with Liz is started when I was young with my family. The discussion that maybe my family is different, but they're my family and I love them. All the discussion was about policy and politics. So I didn't understand it, and I kept on saying, what did this? What did that? How is this? What did this? And no one would answer me. And their answer was, well, look it up, look it up, look it up. Well, that doesn't work for me. So when I got to AUCD and when I had a chance to make a video, I wanted to make a video where where my friends and others could go up to Capitol Hill and talk to our legislators about policy. Like, for example, I talk about home community-based services, or I talk about the ABLE Act, and I explain those issues because I didn't know what they were until I learned what they were. So I could go up to Capitol Hill, or I could go to Annapolis, the capital in Maryland, and talk to our legislator rather than getting support from our supporters like John Chita at AUCD or my supervisor at AUCD. So I worked with our former director and our former policy director. They're no longer at AUCD now at this time to make Tuesdays with Liz happen. And I didn't know what it was called, but that's the kind of vision that I had. I work with my producer to choose a policy topic. We'll talk about what I want or what's timely. So, like, for example, in late summer, we were talking about having HCBS as a hot topic. HCBS stands for Home Community Based Services. That was the president wanted $400 billion in the Build Back Better agenda. So he, and there, to support home community-based services. So that was a big topic. So we would talk about who I could interview. Either I would find someone to interview or present by myself. Sometimes I'll just talk about community-based services on my own. And then she also will film the video. She'll also caption the video. It's very important to AUCD that our videos are captioned so everyone can understand and can participate and listen to the video. She'll also edit the video, and she'll also post the video to our social media platforms. And since 2015, we have made over 200 episodes of Tuesdays with Liz. I think up to now, we probably are up to 300 or 400 videos. And we used to have it on a weekly basis on Tuesdays, but now we're just doing it on a monthly basis. So the first Tuesday of the month. The purpose of Tuesdays, and I think I went over this, but I'll talk again, is to educate about policy so someone can go up to to Capitol Hill and say, oh yeah, I understand what HCBS is or what ABLE Act is, to advocate to make change on their own and to help everyone understand policy, not just about people with disabilities. Started, I originally in 2015 thought it's a video for self-advocates or people with disabilities, but no, a lot. It has grown to so many people, trainees in the network, people who are learning how to be in the network, who want to be doctors, who want to be researchers, who want to do this or that. So it has grown. One of our favorite saying is nothing abolished without us. So if there's a saying, if there's a discussion, I demand to be at that table, or my friends demand. It's not a question about can we be at that table, but demand to be at that table, because it's our life. And if there's time, I'll share a story about that, but I don't know if there is time. This is a video, a live video of our latest video, one of our latest videos. We sent it to Casey from Pennsylvania.
With so many important issues for families, for seniors, for people with disabilities, for workers. But the so-called HCBS part of it, as you noted, the policy is contained in the Better Care, Better Jobs Act. What we're trying to do there is to make sure that if you're a person with a disability and you want to have care in your home or in the community, you should have not only the right to have that care delivered in the home, in your home or in the community, but you should have access to the opportunity to have that kind of care. So the only way to do that for and to help seniors as well as people with disabilities is to pass a bill which allows states to have more Medicaid funding so that they can expand these services. And our bill can expand services for seniors and people with disabilities by more than 3 million Americans.
So that's just a snippet of the videos and on the website, there's many, many more videos. And these are some how people with disability can advocate for change. Well, learn about policies that affects them. As I said, Tuesdays with Liz, you can subscribe to our disability policy news. And what I like about the disability policy news, it comes out every Monday. There's a section about a plain language section. So there's a section, there's a wonky, what I like to call wonky language. And then underneath that section, I write the section about, well, what does that mean in plain language? There's also, we invite you to write a policy talk if you're interested. And Policy Talk is just basically a policy blog. And if you're interested in a subject, please contact me and I'll put you in touch with the person that is in charge of the Policy Talk. You can also write letters, make calls, or visit legislators. And you might think that you can't go up on Capitol Hill now because of the pandemic, but you can. You can make a virtual visit. I have had many virtual visits just within the last month on 14C, so you can do that, or you can also go to your own Capitol and make an appointment. So please do that. It's really important. Or you can make calls. They also like to put you do social media. So tag your senators or your representative about an issue that you care about. And then on our website, there's my top 10 tips to build a relationship with your member of Congress. It's important to build those relationships. Okay. And my dreams for a future of Tuesdays with Liz, more people with disability explaining policy. I would love someone to write, do a Tuesdays with Liz. It might not be called Tuesdays with Liz, but people can call whatever Fridays with Martha or Tuesdays with Wednesday with Jeff or whatever to explain policy. And more people with disability advocating with their legislators. I can't be the only one who advocate because nothing about us without a need to be true for everyone and everywhere. This is my information if you're interested and how to link and subscribe to Tuesdays with Liz on my YouTube channel. Thank you very much. And I'll be glad to answer questions later.
Thank you so much, Liz. That was great. That was very interesting. And I really appreciate that. I was looking at some of the videos from Tuesdays with Liz, and you've got some really great stories there that you've shared. So we really appreciate you coming. You did say you had a story that you wanted to tell if there was time. And I think if it's a short story, we do have time.
Yes.
Stop, that's fine.
Yes. This is about, this goes back to nothing about us without us. When I was probably 2021, I was at Thanksgiving with my family, and our Thanksgiving is with cousins and aunts and uncles. And I'm telling you all that because it relates to the story. My parents called a business meeting, and guess who wasn't invited to that meeting? And to make it worse, my cousin who was there for Thanksgiving, my parents asked him to, quote, babysit me. Who would babysit a 21-year-old person? But they wanted, what they wanted was that I would not go downstairs and hear the discussion. Well, yes, I will not understand that discussion. And to this day, I still don't understand the discussion. I know what the meeting was about. So I would not understand that discussion, but that's not the point. The point is that I am part of that family. I'm part of the family, and I deserve to be at that table and that meeting. So please don't think that even if people with disabilities cannot understand their, or you don't think that people told you that we can't understand the discussion. Don't invite, it's important to still invite us to a meeting.
Definitely, definitely. Thank you for sharing that. I'm sorry that happened, and I bet your family was very sorry when they realized what they had done to you.
Yes. I taught them something.
You definitely did. I'm sure they will never forget that either. So thanks again to Liz for her excellent presentation. And now we're going to move on to welcome Jeff Johnson. So Jeff, if you can go ahead and turn your camera on. And Jeff Johnson is president of People First of Missouri and vice president of Columbia, Missouri People First. And he will be talking about a project on segregated education and the school to prison pipeline. So Jeff, we're gonna share your slides so you can let us know when you wanna go to the next slide. But if you could go ahead and say a few words to describe yourself and anything else you wanna say about yourself and then get started, thank you.
Sure. Thank you, Joanne. My name is Jeff Johnson, and myself as a Black African-American, 6 feet tall. I'm wearing black eyeglasses, and I'm also wearing a light blue shirt, and I'm bald-headed. I cut my hair short. So I'm from Columbia, Missouri. So again, I want to thank everybody for allowing me to be part of you guys' conference this year. And by the way, Liz, great presentation. So I'm going to talk to you today about a project that I put together called The School Pipeline to Prison by SORTEC. And what SORTEC stands for, Self-Advocacy Technology Assistant. Okay, about the fellow, again, you know, as I told you, my name is Jeff Johnson, and I'm from Missouri. And the segregated project that I put on was due to the fact that I wanted to do something about the school pipeline to prison. And I also had a host by the name of Mark Satterwhite, which you see his name there. He works for organizations that deals with people with intellectual disability. And that organization is named Boone County Family Resources. And my project was, the reason why I wanted to do this project is because I wanted students with disabilities, students of color, and their parents to know their rights and to know where to turn for help. Because a lot of people didn't know where to turn for help when it comes to their kids being pushed out. I also formed a steering committee to make a plan. We held a focus group and did some research. So that's why that I wanted to, you know, before I do this project, I wanted to put this committee together. And the project went, you know, as planned, except one part is that the school would not let us into, you know, do a survey. So, and we also did the national research shows that there were more Black students with disabilities are nearly four times more likely to receive multiple out-of-school suspension and almost two times more likely to be expelled than white students with disabilities. But anyway, back to what I was saying about the students that were being pushed out, there were more African-Americans that were being pushed out, and those, kids with intellectual disabilities that were being pushed out of the school. So that was one of the reasons why I put the panel together. And as you can look down below where I was talking about the students with disability as well, as a whole, are more than twice as likely to receive out-of-school suspension compared to students with no disability. And here's my steering committee that I had put together. As you can see, some of the names here, I'm gonna call them out. The lady on the left here, some of you might see it on the right, Cheryl Miller, which is an attorney, a great friend of mine that we worked together years ago back in 2000, to where there was an organization called Grassroots Organizing. And what that group did was to advocate for those that couldn't advocate for themselves. We dealt with housing issues, we dealt with Medicaid issues, we dealt with social security issues, we dealt with a lot of issues that was brought before us. And Mark Satterwhite, which you can tell there, he was my co-host that I just named. He works for with people with intellectual disability. And Christina Devine there, which is an attorney for that same organization, she's an attorney there, and she was part of my steering committee as well, which is her husband just became a judge for the Columbia Boone County Court here in Columbia, Missouri. And what you can see, Katie Kendrick, which is our president for People First of Boone County, she was also part of the committee. And as you can see down below her is Kevin Williams, which, you know, he is a parent of a family member that has intellectual disability. So he was also part of the committee. And as you can see, Nicole Seaman, she is a parent of a child that had intellectual disability, and also her husband sits on the school board here in Columbia, Missouri. So these were the steering committee diversity that I have picked for my steering committee, because I wanted somebody that I knew I can trust, somebody that I knew that would help me get the project done and find a lot of great information. So that's why I put the steering committee together. And also you can see there's information here to where we put a flyer together, which, you know, to invite the focus group. And the reason for that focus group was I wanted, you know, parents, youth, and other people that was at that focus group to be able to give me some information to help me with the project as well. And some of those are parents and youth that were there and other agencies that were there at the focus group. They provided me with great information, and we jetted it all down and we put it towards the project. And one of the things that I liked it about the focus group is that most of those parents, you know, besides myself, you know, wasn't the only one that had a lot of issues with the school. But one of the things that we did make sure of, that we didn't want anything like to where the school versus us versus them. You know, we all wanted everybody to kind of work together and come up with better solutions. And that's what those parents and the youth and other agencies that was in that focus group did. They came up with some great information for this project. And here you can see focus group one here, where we held it on October 26, 2019, at the Columbia Library. Parents, grandparents, students, and representatives from Mid-Missouri Legal Service, SAP, that's another organization. Race Matters, that's another organization. And the ACLU and People First of Boone County, you know, all participated in this you know, with this focus group. As you can see in the picture that, you know, especially on the far left there, where I'm listening to what the parents and other agencies were wanting to, you know, put into this project and give great information, in which they've done that. That was a really awesome group. And here, there was another focus group, as you can see. Some who were at the first focus group wanted to continue this discussion. We met again in November at the host SAC at Boone County Family Resource. And as you can see in that picture, you see my wife, my daughter, and some other members from the first focus group. We were still discussing some of the things that we would like to see put into the project, in which was great. And we're still continuing that. We're just not doing it right at the moment due to the focus of, I shouldn't say focus, but due to the fact of the pandemic. So that's why we haven't really been meeting, but we're going to try to pick this back up so we can get this back going again. And what the focus group finding was is that parents needed to know where to turn for support. Students and their parents needed to know their rights. Teachers need special training and support in order to handle behavior deficiency. School policy needs to change so it isn't so easy to kick students out of school or refer them to juvenile authorities. These should be less restored. So basically, this came from parents that was involved in that focus group. And they were right about, you know, the support. And they was also right about, you know, coming up with something about their rights. Because if you look at it, most people with intellectual disability or kids of color, they just don't know who to turn to or who to talk to about the issues that they might be having within the school district. And sometimes it might not just be the school district. It can be also in the court, you know, system as well. So this was something that I definitely really was passionate about, is trying to come up with some solutions to help these families and the students as well, to make sure that they had something to go on, to where if they needed to talk to somebody, these were the resources that we can provide for them. Okay, and basically what I learned as a whole, I learned the problem is real in our community and also in our school. I also got to know others who are concerned about the problem and want to help. I also learned students and parents need support and teachers need training. I also got to meet with other local groups like the Special Education Parent Teachers Association, who are willing to partner with. I built on my leadership skills as well. And the resource that was created, as you can see, this is out there on the website about the school pipeline in prison, is to where we, you know, created a resource guide for parents and the community to be able to go through and find some of those resources like the ACLU or, you know, partners in policy making, you know, things like that. So that way those parents will be able to go and find those type of resources. So it's out there on the SORTEX website as well. And also my partners that, you know, they were helpful. You know, as you can see that I'm talking with one of the members of the Special Education Parents and Teachers Association with the attorney there. And also, I also partnered with Community Partnership of the Ozark, which is out of Springfield, Missouri. And I also worked with them along with similar to the same project that I was working on, the school pipeline in prison. And also you can see again here where, you know, I was talking with, you know, family members at the steering committee committee meeting. You can also see on the right there where I'm talking with the ACLU there about this project, and they gave great information for parents and also for my project as well. And also, if you can see right here, where I'm networking at the MODI, at the Missouri Disability Empowerment event that they put on for parents. And as you can see on the left, and some of you might see it on the right there, where I'm introducing myself and shaking hands with, now he's a judge now. And he was one of the person that told me that if I needed anything from him, and that he will help me talk with other judges, and, you know, about this special project that I was putting on about the school pipeline in prison, that he will be assist to that. So I'm still reaching out to him as well. And as you can see, myself and another former colleague of mine with People First of Boone County, we was also invited to that event to give out information about my project that I was doing. The leadership and policy results. One of the things that I am interested in working with legislators to file bills to stop restraints and seclusions and limit out of school suspension. Just to go back a little bit about the restraints, I do know Missouri has passed a bill about the restraints and seclusion on that. I haven't really seen the bill, but I know it has been passed. But one of the things that I do want to work on and talk with legislators about the out-of-school suspension. I also want to be sure and have a voice with the school board, in which I did talk with one board member before he became a board member. Now he's getting ready to run for the city mayor here in Columbia, Missouri. So I'm still going to be trying to talk with him more to see where we all at about the school pipeline to prison before he decides to leave the school board. During the spring, I used my leadership skills to help with the Disability Rights Legislative Day at the state capitol. This is something that we put on every year, as Liz mentioned in her presentation about going and talking with your legislator and all that. That is the same thing that we do here in the state of Missouri every year around March or April, one of the two, is that we'll go and talk with our legislators about issues that is more important to us, you know, and try to get them to jump on board to get some of those bills passed. And the local advocacy for school policy, as you can see, my wife and my son and some other People First members, we met with David Seema. He was a candidate for the school board. He is now on the school board. This is the gentleman on your far left over there. And some people might see him on the right just by looking at the PowerPoint here. But like I said, you know, he's now on the school board, but now he's getting ready to run for city council, or not city council, excuse me, but city mayor here in Columbia, Missouri. So I'm hoping that, you know, I can meet up with him again if he decides to be elected as our next city mayor. And here where you see where I'm in the background, I was introducing some of the representatives. Kind of talked about, you know, the restraints and seclusion bill. You know, these guys, they did sponsor that bill. And, you know, because if you look at it, my son has some experience about being restraints and seclusion in the school classroom during the time that he was in school. But now that he's out of school, he's been out of school for the past, I'll say, 2 years now. But like I said before, that bill did get passed. Okay, the role of the host. The role of the host of my project as a host, Boone County Family Resource, providing meeting space, use of equipment, and their paper. Mark Satterwhite took meeting notes. So I could focus on leading or facilitating the meetings. He also, the host also You know, you can see right there some of the names that I already mentioned before. You know, they help develop the resource guide. Boone County Family Resource supported people with IDD. They also included public school students who may be experiencing the issue. And I also focused on it. The project helped bring us into better touch with the issues. So this whole project, you know, it just brought us all together to continue the work. And to be honest with you, I have been getting a lot of calls and a lot of invitation to come and talk about this same project. And about the employment results of the goal, well, I have a goal to be self-employed as a consultant and advocate for students' rights. My research during this project has helped me prepare. I am currently the co-chair for the Real Voices and Real Choices Conference. And when I say Real Voices and Real Choices Conference, it's a conference that the state of Missouri has put on through the Department of Mental Health. Due to the fact this was something back in 2008 that we did a summit on, and then we put a committee together, and then we also, a year later, we put on a conference. And I'm going to save my questions and answers, you know, for later.
Okay, thank you so much. That was great. That was excellent to see all the participation you had, lots of helpful partners, lots of participation throughout the community, and a very interesting and sounds like a successful project. So thank you so much for sharing that. And
thank you.
If you want to turn off your camera, we'll now ask Clark Rachfal, Director of Advocacy and Governmental Affairs at American Council of the Blind, to turn on his camera. And a reminder, there's no slides for Clark's presentation, but he will be talking to us about his many policy experiences in his role at ACB and other organizations. So Clark, if you would like to say a few words to describe or introduce yourself, and then go ahead with your presentation.
Absolutely. Thank you so much. Hello, everyone. My name is Clark Rachfal. I am the Director of Advocacy and Governmental Affairs for the American Council of the Blind. ACB is a nationwide membership organization that strives to increase the security, independence, economic opportunity, and quality of life for people who are blind and visually impaired. I am a light-skinned male with short brown hair, from what I believe is a medium gray shirt, and with a purple wall as a background behind me. Thank you so much for the opportunity to present here on this great panel and speak with you all today. Primarily, I'm going to focus on accessibility of health and wellness, and how that relates to people who are blind and experiencing vision loss. The leading cause of blindness in the United States, we'll start with older Americans, which is age-related macular degeneration, but also includes things like glaucoma and cataracts and many other conditions. Roughly a third of seniors over the age of 65 will have some form of vision loss. For working age adults, ages 18 to 64, the leading cause of blindness is diabetes and complications related to diabetic retinopathy. Why is this important, right? So about roughly 60 million Americans have a disability. Roughly half, 30 million Americans have severe vision loss, vision loss that impacts one or more major life functions. However, our medical system, as many of us know and have experienced over the past year and the COVID-19 pandemic, is not necessarily accessible or set up in a manner to consider the needs of individuals with disabilities, right? So for our seniors with disabilities, so there are estimates that for medical conditions for adults over the age of 40, there is roughly a $50 billion burden on the U.S. economy. And that's from the Vision Health Initiative at the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention, CDC. With that being the case, and knowing that routine eye exams can help to mitigate the deteriorating lifestyles of our seniors experiencing vision loss, it may come as a surprise to some, likely not all, that Medicare actually has a statutory exclusion of providing vision coverage. And in 2008, the Centers for Medicare and Medicaid Services went a bit further and extended the vision coverage exclusion. They interpreted it very broadly to include everything with a lens. So low vision devices, magnifiers, video magnifiers, anything that can augment the magnification, color contrast, whether a wearable, handheld, or table mounted low vision device is not eligible for Medicare coverage. Why does this matter? As I mentioned, you know, our seniors and this population is anticipated to increase as the baby boomer generation ages. Roughly a third of them have vision loss, right? But also around 25% of seniors statistics show that roughly 25% of seniors over the age of 65 experience a fall every year. This more than doubles if you are a senior with visual impairments or experiencing vision loss. Some of the things that the CDC has documented to reduce these numbers include routine eye exams, corrective lenses for eyeglasses, as well as low vision aids and devices, all of which are not covered by Medicare. It's estimated that adding a vision benefit to Medicare, as is attempted to be being done right now in the budget reconciliation package, would cost about $20 billion. However, the Medicare, Medicaid, and insurance companies currently spend far more than this, and the burden to our economy is far greater from the health conditions resulting from a lack of vision coverage and the costs of seniors experiencing falls each year. Going back to our working age population, who is experiencing systemic rates of diabetes, a condition that we know disproportionately impacts people of color, African Americans, Hispanics, Asian Pacific Islanders, and Native Americans. This is, I always get a little tongue-tied here because it just baffles my mind. So knowing that diabetes is a leading cause of blindness for working age adults, and knowing that diabetes is a preventable condition, how can diabetes or diabetic retinopathy be prevented? With routine eye exams, managing one's blood sugar, routine exercise and fitness. However, there are no requirements that durable medical equipment be accessible. Again, so the leading cause of blindness for working age adults is diabetes and diabetic retinopathy. Some of the ways to reduce the risk of diabetic retinopathy: routine eye exams, as we just stated, not covered by Medicare, and typically an added bit of coverage for insurance policies. Regular monitoring, testing, and management of one's blood sugar levels. However, there are no requirements for durable medical equipment, including continuous glucose monitors, as well as insulin pumps, to be accessible for people with disabilities, including individuals who have lost their vision due to diabetes. And then the third, exercise and fitness, which is also an interesting one, because although an international standards setting body, ASTM, in 2013 created international guidelines for inclusive and accessible exercise and fitness equipment, which includes tactile user interfaces, as well as audio output for people who are blind and experiencing vision loss, there are no regulations to enforce these standards. In my view, and the view of our members in ACB, as well as our affiliate ACB Diabetics in Action, this is not just an oversight, but it's wrong. So what can we do to remedy these problems? Well, I mentioned that there's efforts to get Medicare vision coverage in the budget reconciliation package. There's also efforts underway to require the accessibility of durable medical equipment. And again, I focused on diabetes and diabetic retinopathy and equipment for monitoring, managing, and testing for diabetes because it's the most prevalent cause. But that's not the only thing that these regulations would apply to. They would apply to heart rate monitors, pulse oximeters, you know, everything that we've experienced over the past year with the growing of remote monitoring and diagnostics of, you know, telehealth, remote healthcare, in-home monitoring and care. In addition to these durable medical products, we need to ensure that telehealth is accessible for people with disabilities and people who are blind and visually impaired. This would allow our folks to maintain independence, remain integrated in their community, and take back control of their health. We talked about the impact of, you know, vision loss and falls on our senior population. According to the CDC, diabetes and diabetic retinopathy has a $50 billion a year burden on our economy from medical costs, from Medicare and Medicaid costs, and lost economic potential. For ACB, another key driver of us being able to, and people who are blind and experiencing vision loss, to take back control of our health, is ensuring the accessibility of exercise and fitness equipment. So we certainly want to make sure that our friends and family and community members can independently manage their health conditions, but we also want to provide individuals the tools and the resources so that they don't become subject to diabetes. They don't acquire diabetic retinopathy in the first place. So we're also working with Congress, as I mentioned, for regulations around durable medical equipment. We're also working for regulations around accessible exercise and fitness equipment. So at this point, I'm glad to say that there have been bills introduced in the US Congress for accessible exercise and fitness equipment. Bills have been introduced in both the House and the Senate. The Exercise and Fitness for All Act, it's S-2504 and H.R. 4756. And there is also a bill, the Medical Device Nonvisual Accessibility Act, that has been introduced in the House of Representatives that would require accessibility for durable medical equipment. And that bill is H.R. 4853. As we work with Congress and the federal government to implement legislation and regulations requiring accessibility standards for exercise and fitness equipment, as well as durable medical equipment, we're also attempting to work with industry and collaborate with our corporate partners. Because we know sometimes it can take a long time to pass a bill. It can take a long time for a rulemaking. And we know that our partners in the broader community, they want to be able to serve as many consumers as they can and reach as many potential customers as possible. So in 2020, ACB was proud that through our collaboration with Peloton International, the Google Talkback screen reader was enabled on the Peloton Bike and Bike Plus. Much like we see in the medical industry, Peloton is using an Android operating system-based tablet for their user interface. The beauty of when an off-the-shelf product, like in a tablet using the Android operating system, Microsoft, Apple's operating systems, is that accessibility is already baked in. It's there in the operating system. It just takes some education on the part of the disability rights community, at ACB, at our partners in the cross-disability community, to work with and communicate the availability of these technologies to these companies. So we've noticed the same thing in the medical device space, whether it's for continuous glucose monitors or for remote monitoring of heart arrhythmias, tachycardia, irregular heartbeats. A lot of times it's a wearable sensor that then connects to a smartphone that already has accessibility built into it, but that the creators of the app didn't know about, or unfortunately sometimes it just coded around, right? So what can we do to raise the profile of the fact that these features are built in? How can we work with the research community to show the ease of access for engaging, or in some cases like exercise and fitness equipment and other durable medical good products, the ease of including these features to ensure that these products, these devices are accessible, making sure that they're accessible so our folks can take charge of their health, live more independently as engaged and active members of their community, and contribute to our society more fully. In addition to working collaboratively with industry and the cross-disability community and working with government, at ACB, we are also launching a multi-year campaign. We're calling it our Get Up and Get Moving campaign, because we know that throughout the pandemic, as our folks have been socially distant, in many cases, not just distant, but isolated, that we've led stagnant lives as well, with impacts on our social inclusion, on our mental and physical well-being. So we are working to create greater public awareness, increase partnerships, and raise more knowledge of our advocacy efforts in the health and wellness space. I encourage all folks to visit our website and learn more about our Get Up and Get Moving campaign as we embark here into 2022. And I hope that everyone can get up and get moving. A little bit of movement, especially with accessible exercise and fitness equipment and accessible durable medical equipment, will do us all good as we come out of this pandemic and embrace living life to the fullest. So thank you very much for the opportunity to speak here with you today, and I'm happy to answer any questions.
Thank you so much, Clark. That was sobering and very interesting. Being on Medicare myself, I'm learning about some of those things that you talked about and do agree. I find it quite shocking that some things are not covered, like vision and dental, which are issues that everyone has, and especially as one gets older. So it's great to know that you're working on these policy issues and these changes to some of the laws out there. And we really appreciate your sharing that information with us. So we do have time to take a question or two before we go on to our discussion session. And we have a comment from one of our participants. Another factor is to remedy the food deserts or lack of access to grocery stores with robust food options. So I'll take your comment on that, Clark, as part of what you've been talking about. You're on mute. Sorry.
Great. Thank you. Just making sure. Yes. So certainly for ACB and our members, the things that we've heard about the most throughout the pandemic are transportation access and information access. A lot of our members rely heavily on delivery services, either because, time and money, right? Things that are in short supply for everyone, especially people with disabilities. And as it became more difficult to due to food deserts or due to lack of accessible transportation options, many folks have relied on food delivery services. However, during the pandemic, these services became very popular, much like we've noticed a lot of accommodations and things typically adopted by people with disabilities, like remote work and distance learning. Accommodations you used to have to fight tooth and nail for became popular by the general public. So these services typically had much longer delays, which made it more difficult for folks to gain access. And these are for folks that can afford access, but also had access to technology as well as these delivery services. Certainly a much larger issue is raised by the question of fresh food, grocery deserts for people with disabilities, people who are low income and other socioeconomic groups is a major issue that can have long lasting and deteriorating impacts on one's health and wellness.
Thank you, Clark. We do have one other question. I think we can squeeze it in. Does ACB, this is from Jess Chaikin, who is one of our reactors. Does ACB do any work with university programs pairing developers and designers with members to get the concept of accessibility ingrained early?
Absolutely. What a great question. So yes, ACB does work with universities and developers. We are actually a member of Teach Access. If folks aren't familiar with teachaccess.org, but it was an organization that was founded to introduce accessibility professionals to the STEM university curriculum structures, along with professors and students, so that students can be exposed to universal design, accessible by design in the classroom. Because one of the things that companies and industry partners have been noticing is that when they're going to hire someone for accessibility, if they are fresh out of a degree in software engineering or computer information systems or something like that, they don't have a background in accessibility and they have to be coached and taught on the job to design with accessibility in mind. So we are working with Teach Access to provide the consumer, the end user, but also the potential employee perspective on why accessibility matters, But for ACB's part, we're also trying to educate the broader public on why accessible media and content and information is important, like audio description, like using alt text to provide information about your images and posts on social media and everywhere else.
Great. Thank you so much, Clark. And I want to thank all of our panelists today for sharing their grassroots policy experiences. And we're going to get ready to move on to our discussion session that will be led by our KTDR director, Kathleen Murphy. So I'd like to ask all the presenters to turn their cameras on, as well as the three participants who have volunteered to be reactors to today's session. So Kathleen, are you ready to take it over and start facilitating our discussion session to follow up the panel?
I am. So thank you, Joanne. And I did pop it in the chat earlier today, but for those of you who missed that, I'm Kathleen Murphy. I'm director of the Center on Knowledge Translation for Disability and Rehabilitation Research, the Center on KTDR, which is sponsoring this conference. And I am a white woman with shoulder length blonde hair, wearing kind of an off-white sweater and glasses, and my background is blurred, so there's not much to see there. So we are excited that we've got some fantastic reactors lined up for today. So I will let, I'm just gonna list each of them, and then I'll go to each of you and you can add any information that you might wanna add to your bio, describe who you are, and then we'll go back around once just to see if you have some immediate reaction to any of what you've heard so far today. So I'm going to start with Jess Chaikin from the National Rehabilitation Information Center. Many of you might have known or heard of that as NARIC. You want to say hi, Jess?
Hi. Yep. So I'm Jess. I identify as a cisgender white woman. I've got glasses with little flowers on them and a blue sweater and a blurred background wherein a cat or two may appear. And most of you know me from NARIC.
Mm-hmm. Okay. And we have Jessica. We have two Jessicas. So we're just Chaikin is agreed to be Jess for today. And Jessica Lukfar, who's joining us from Portland State University, is our Jessica. So Jessica, do you want to say hello?
Hello, yes, I work for Portland State University, but I actually live in Texas, so it's a lot to, it's kind of confusing. To describe myself, I'm light-complected female in my 30s, and I have long blonde hair. I'm wearing a blouse that has navy blue in the background and then white flowers on it. And it's kind of blurred, but I am in a wheelchair. I have a cerebral palsy, so my headrest is kind of blurred for some reason. But so currently, the work that I do is for the Regional Research Institute at Portland State University, and what I'm focusing on right now, I work on a project for supporting working caregivers. So.
Super important, as we've heard from Liz especially. And our third reactor for today is Regina Rice, who is with the Vocational Rehabilitation in Florida, which is housed in their Department of Education. Regina, do you want to say hello?
Hi, everyone. My name is Regina Rice, and I am a white woman with medium length brown hair. I'm wearing glasses and a black and white striped shirt.
Okay, so now we're gonna go around once again and just, all of our reactors have seen the information or had some information about this panel. So compared to those of you who are attending and, are just hearing this for the first time, they have had a little bit of time to think about it. So, you don't have to, Jessica and Regina, say anything right now because we do have other questions from the participants. But if you would like to say, some thoughts that you had, this is your opportunity. So I'm just going to go back around. So Jess, is there anything that you wanted to you know, add or ask?
Yeah, there were, so a couple of things struck me. One is the importance of local advocacy. We certainly learned in the last few elections and that change happens locally with local elections, local school boards. And we're certainly seeing a lot of advocacy in local school boards, local health boards, and things like that. So I was really struck by the importance of acting locally if you're going to be an advocate. The other thing that struck me is, again, lately we've seen this kind of resistance to science. And as part of the conference, we're talking about how do we get science into the mainstream, into practice, and into policy. So I think the idea of having local advocates, people who are in the community, who are visible in the community, kind of fostering, pushing the science into policy, maybe one way to get past some of that resistance to science that we're seeing lately. And the third thing that struck me was listening to Clark, the idea of personas for developers, giving developers and designers a person, the idea of a person to hang on as they're creating and developing tools, apps, technology, seems so important. It's great to have an idea of, it would be great if we had an app that did this, but for whom and how are they going to use it? And having those personas, I think, can be really key. So those were my initial thoughts.
Mm-hmm. And that's actually interesting because it's another way of the personas and being local are both ways against being general.
Right. And you're giving people a person to hang the idea on, whether mm-hmm. it's an actual person, an advocate standing up and talking, or having this idea, this persona.
Mm-hmm. Exactly. So Jessica, how about you? Did you have any, you know, kind of immediate feedback?
Sure. The way I arranged my questions was I did it by presenter. So I have a question for each of you. If this is too long, please let me know. So for Liz, you know, as I'm doing my own research, I know that your show does talk about disability and policies. Is there another source that you would recommend just to kind of get a general knowledge of the policies that affect disability right now, or, you know, the current ones that are being researched, so I can kind of get a handle on that so that when I come into these policies that are in the research or that the research project is working on, I can have a better understanding on from that perspective.
So Liz, if you want to go ahead and answer that, it's fine.
I forgot that I was on mute. Thank you, Jessica, for that question. I don't know of a policy show like mine. There are other self-advocates who are doing policy. There has been a person in Georgia named Martha Hayworth who has done a show like mine, but the organization that has done a lot of policy work who is people with disability is the Autistic Self-Advocacy Network, and they have done a lot of policy work around the same issues that I talk about. I also know the ARC, but Nate put in the chat on SAPE, Self-Advocates Becoming Empowered is another self-advocacy organization. I don't know if they have done a lot as right now around policy per se, but they are a self-advocacy organization around the country, and every state has a chapter. They're not all named self-advocate coming in power, and that's why they are called it's the people first groups around the country, like what Jeff has talked about, and I think Jeff is a member of People First of Missouri. Mm-hmm. And the reason why South Africa coming in power isn't called People First of the U.S. is because not every chapter is called People First.
Okay, thanks for that clarification, Liz. Jessica, I'm going to turn to Regina, and then we can come back to your other two questions, okay?
Sure.
Yep. So, Regina?
Yeah, I just had the one thing that really struck me was when Liz was speaking, and she was talking about being able to talk to legislators virtually, because I know during the pandemic, you know, that's all how we worked and that's how we kept in touch. And I hadn't thought about that. And it just made me think that it opens up the door a lot for people to people who might not otherwise have the opportunity to get in front of people, to get in front of them. And I just wondered if she found the virtual meetings to be as effective as in-person meetings were.
Thank you for that question. I myself don't like virtual meetings as well. I have gotten used to them over the last 18, 19 months, however long we're here. But I don't think they work as well for people with disability because you can't hear very well. You can't be part of the conversation as well. Sometimes people have come in on computer issues like I do. It's really hard. I have learned a lot within the last 18, 19 months. But I can't say that I like working on the computer. And Nate, I just saw the chat, he put AAPD, the American Association for People with Disability, how can I ever forget them? They're one of the best organizations that are working on policy issues, mostly on the voting issues. NICL is a really wonderful organization called National Council on Independent Living. And they're the organization for sales around the country. So those are two of the other organizations that are run by and for people with disabilities.
And yes, that's so important. Jessica, you mentioned that you had a question for Jeff.
Yes. So thank you for your presentation as well. I had a question that kind of went beyond your study because you were talking about focus groups and how, you know, people get to a place and they don't know where to turn to. I was going to kind of go off a little bit on that and ask if anyone knows like a peer group focus group, especially for kids with disabilities, maybe older kids that are closer to, you know, teens, you know, getting ready to transition to college, things of that sort. Because I know when I was growing up, I didn't have access to that. So what was told to me was like a rosy, cheery version of there's always going to be some agency or something to help you. And so I would think something like a peer group, because I know there's some for people with mental disorders, they kind of peer talk to each other. And mm-hmm. and I haven't heard one on
those are really helpful resources, mm-hmm. Jessica. Yeah. So I want to give Jeff some time to answer your really fantastic question. So maybe take about a minute, Jeff, and address some of what she's raising.
Yeah. To be honest with you, I noticed here in Columbia, I mean, there are some peer groups here for some people. I do know that they do have a, but they just put this in place a few years ago. It's called it's called the Youth Commission that was designed for students by the city council here a few years ago. But I guess where I was kind of going with that is due to the fact that mostly people that lives in a low income area, they don't even know that those, you know, groups even exist. They don't even know that the resources is there. So, I mean, I was going through this with my son, you know, when he was in school, because we've been dealing with this for years and years. I mean, ever since he was like probably 3 years old. So I just kind of made it up on my own, decided to say, okay, there's something, I have to do something. So after the years have passed, you know, so I decided that I wanted to do something like this because, I mean, you just get tired of trying to fight by yourself. So yes. I decided that I wanted to get some more people involved, you know, that will be able to help me with this. And that's what I've done. But I mean, you're right. There are some groups out there, but a lot of parents just don't know that they even exist because, again, you know, they want to try to find somebody that they can trust, that they know that's going to be willing to help them and not fib to them. Because sometimes, you know, people say they're going to do something, then they don't do it. And then you go back and say, you know, I thought such and such said they was going to help me with this. And they never follow through. So it's just that trust, you know, that I look at. And I think that's what parents and youth, sometimes they look at. They look at that trust. So if they feel that, well, Jeff said he's going to do something, he's going to do it. So they're going to always look to me and say, hey, I know somebody, Jeff, he's going to do it, you know. So
exactly.
There is some out there.
Thank you, Jeff. And we all know that such an important part of neuroless translation is relationship building, and trust is essential to that. And so I think our participants trust we're going to stay on our timetable. So we are going to close out this discussion, which means everybody who has been voicing anything right now is going to not only turn off your mic, but turn off your camera. So the two little icons at the bottom, and we will be joined again by Joanne Starks and a new face to our attendees, David Guff.